This video will be the first of a sequence of videos to discuss 3D rotations. As a starting point, any solid body orientation may be defined by an orthogonal matrix B. The columns of this orthogonal matrix B specify the directions of the three principal axes of the solid body that it's affixed to in the inertial reference frame. All right, so here's the first column is in some direction, the second column is orthogonal to the first, and the third column is orthogonal to both of those in a right-handed sense. And so the determinant of this B matrix is equal to 1, so it corresponds to a right-handed coordinate system. And so if we start with some matrix B, let's call it B1 as our starting point, and then we go through some rotation and get to some other orientation B2, we can always relate B2 to B1 through a matrix expression. B2 is equal to R times B1. This R is essential. It's called the rotation matrix, corresponding to how we get from B1 to some B2. And so we're going to spend a lot of time thinking about how we can write and think about the rotation matrix R. So to begin with, we just have this expression B2 is equal to R times B1. So let's put that in brackets, multiply from the right by B1 transpose, which equals B1 inverse because B is orthogonal. And so we have R is equal to B2 times B1 transpose. So then let's take R times itself transposed. So we have this expression times itself transposed. And so B1 transpose times B1 is just going to be I. B2 times B2 transpose is just going to be I. And so we're going to get R times R transpose is equal to I. And so R itself is an orthogonal matrix. And looking at this expression, it's clear that the determinant of this, so the determinant of products is just equal to the product of the determinants, and the determinant of R transpose is just equal to the determinant of R. So the determinant of R must be equal plus or minus 1. Now we're going to consider one special case of this. We're going to consider the case with the determinant of R equal to 1, not the other one that with the determinant of R equal to minus 1, because we're going to consider the basis matrix B as being a right-handed matrix. And so as we go from one orientation to another orientation, these three vectors, the three columns of B, are going to remain oriented in a right-handed way as they started. And so the determinant of B1 is going to equal 1, and the determinant of B2 is going to equal 1. So we're specifically interested in the case where the determinant of R is equal to 1. The other possibility, where we start with a right-handed coordinate system, but we end up with a left-handed coordinate system, so the determinant of B1 is equal to 1, but the determinant of B2 is equal to minus 1, corresponds to both possibly some rotation and a reflection, where one of the axes now faces the opposite direction. And we can't do that simply by rotating a solid body in general. And so the case with determinant of R is equal to 1 is called a proper rotation, and that's what we're going to spend all of our attention on. The other case, called an improper rotation, can't be done just by rotating an object, so we're not going to consider that case. Okay, so from here, the basic notion of a rotation corresponds to a 3x3 orthogonal matrix R called the rotation matrix. It's orthogonal, and its determinant is equal to 1. So that's what we're going to start from. And we're going to consider a theorem and a useful formula here, and then we're going to look at various ways of interpreting R from there. Okay, so the starting point to understand what R is all about is Euler's rotation theorem, which says that any rotation matrix R may in fact be expressed as a single simple 2D rotation by some angle theta about some rotation axis S1. So if we have some body, we look at some axis through that body, and any rotation matrix R, if we find the right axis through that body, can be expressed actually as just a simple 2D rotation about that axis. And so anything that's in the direction S1 is left unchanged. So this is actually fairly straightforward to prove. So to establish it, let's take a look at the quantity, the determinant of I minus R. Let's just work through this little bit of algebra. So I'll just explain how we work across here. So the determinant of a matrix is equal to the determinant of that matrix transpose. The transpose of sum is just equal to the sum of the transposes. R transpose is just R inverse because R is orthogonal. And so now we're going to factor out minus R inverse. And now we're going to take the determinant of a product is equal to the product of the determinants. And now we're going to note that the determinant of R inverse is equal to 1 over the determinant of R, but the determinant of R is just equal to 1. And so we have simply minus the determinant of I minus R. Add this term to the term on the other side, we see that indeed the determinant of I minus R is equal to 0. So in other words, if we slip a lambda 1 in there, and note that lambda 1 is equal to 1, we can interpret this equation as a statement that lambda 1 is equal to 1 is an eigenvalue of R because it satisfies this equation for the case with lambda 1 is equal to 1. So lambda 1 is equal to 1 is an eigenvalue of R, and we'll call the corresponding eigenvector S1. And so R times S1 is equal to lambda 1 times S1, because lambda 1, S1 are an eigenvalue eigenvector pair. Since lambda 1 is equal to 1, what we actually have in this expression is R times S1 is equal to S1. In other words, if we act this rotation matrix on a vector in the direction S1, nothing happens, right? So everything happens in the plane that's orthogonal to that matrix. And so that's the starting point to establish Euler's rotation theorem. Now, so we call S1 the rotation axis of the rotation matrix R. And now let's consider what happens in the directions orthogonal to that. And so if we have some eigenvalue eigenvector pair, lambda S, then it follows that if we write the expression SH times S, we can slip RH times R into the middle of that, because RH times R is just identity, because R is an orthogonal matrix. So now RS is just lambda times S, and RS conjugate transpose is just lambda conjugate transpose times S conjugate transpose. And so what we have is the length of lambda squared times S conjugate transpose S is equal to S conjugate transpose S. So in other words, the length of lambda squared is equal to 1. Also, of course, the determinant of a matrix is equal to the product of its eigenvalues, and we know that the determinant of R is equal to 1. So the product of lambda 1 times lambda 2 times lambda 3 is equal to 1, and we know that lambda 1 is already equal to 1. So the two remaining eigenvalues that we're looking for, lambda 2 and lambda 3, have a product that's equal to 1. All right, R is a real matrix, so either lambda 2 and lambda 3 are real, and the product is equal to 1, in which case we either have lambda 2 equals lambda 3 equals 1, or lambda 2 equals lambda 3 equals minus 1, or lambda 2 and lambda 3 come as a complex conjugate pair. If they come as a complex conjugate pair, we can write lambda 2 and lambda 3 as C plus SI and C minus SI, with, again, if the length of lambda in the complex plane is equal to 1, then C squared plus S squared is equal to 1, the most general way to achieve this expression, C squared plus S squared is equal to 1, is by taking C as equaling cos theta and S as equaling sine theta for some angle theta. Now, in fact, this case, lambda 2 is equal to C plus SI, lambda 3 equals C minus SI, includes this as a special case. So if we take theta as being 0, then we have C is 1 and S is equal to 0, and we have the case lambda 2 equals lambda 3 equals 1. And if we take theta as being pi, then we have C is equal to negative 1 and S equals 0, which gives us the other case, lambda 2 and lambda 3 is equal to minus 1. So this case here with theta somewhere between 0 and 2 pi inclusive gives us all possibilities that we might have here. Okay, so now let's consider what's happening in the other two directions, S2 and S3. One might think, well, okay, we're working up towards an eigendecomposition here. But actually, an eigendecomposition would be the wrong thing to do, because the second and third eigenvalues might be complex, which means the corresponding eigenvectors might be complex. And what we're looking for is three real vectors in R3 that span the space. And so S1 is our first eigenvector, and we're looking for two vectors that are orthogonal to S1, real vectors that are orthogonal to S1, to consider what happens in the space orthogonal to S1 when we apply the rotation matrix R. So the appropriate fundamental matrix decomposition to use here is the real sure decomposition. So the real Schur decomposition decomposes R in terms of a product of three matrices with structure. The first matrix U is an orthogonal matrix. So we're starting with a real matrix R, and U is going to be a real orthogonal matrix. So U times U transpose is equal to I. And T is going to, in general, be a block upper triangular matrix with 1x1 and 2x2 blocks on the main diagonal. And again, T is going to be real. And in this particular case, T is actually going to turn out to be block diagonal. So it's going to have zeros in the off-diagonal blocks, and on the diagonal, it's going to have a 1x1 block here and a 2x2 block here. And the blocks, together, if we take the eigenvalues of all those blocks on the main diagonal, the union of those give the eigenvalues of R. This is an eigen-revealing decomposition. And so if we order this matrix T such that lambda 1 appears in that first block in the upper left-hand corner, and then if we take the eigenvalues of this 2x2 block in the lower right-hand corner, we will get the eigenvalues lambda 2 and lambda 3. And that can be achieved simply with the CS minus SC matrix. So it's a simple little 2x2 block there, easily verified that the eigenvalues of this 2x2 block down here are simply C plus SI and C minus SI. And the corresponding real Schur vectors, so the second and third columns of U, are columns that are mutually orthogonal and orthogonal to S1. And so we have the eigenvector, the rotation axis, in the first column here. And the remaining two real Schur vectors span the space which is orthogonal to S1. So here we can recognize T as a Givens rotation matrix, and this CS minus SC is simply the simple 2D rotation by the angle theta, corresponding to C is cos theta and S is sine theta. So this corresponds simply to a rotation in the space spanned by U2 and U3, and again, nothing happens in the direction S1. So that's how we can interpret a rotation matrix R. As if we take a look at these three directions, if this is our S1 direction, nothing happens in the S1 direction, and in the space spanned by the other two real Schur vectors, U2 and U3, we're simply going to have a 2D rotation in this coordinate system given by U. Okay, so that gives us a first understanding of what R is. Now what we can do is we can, with that understanding, that we're just going to be doing a simple 2D rotation by an angle theta about a rotation axis S1, we can write a useful formula that codifies that. So we're going to define P prime as the rotation of some vector P about a unit vector U by some angle theta. So I changed notation here. I'm calling the unit vector U instead of the rotation axis S1, but it's the same thing here. So we're going to be rotating about some unit vector U by an angle theta. And so what we're going to hypothesize here is that P prime is related to P if we rotated about some vector U by an angle theta by this formula. So we're going to set out to prove that. And this proof is just a minor amount of algebra as well. And so what we're going to do is we're going to orthogonally decompose P into two components, one which is parallel to U and one which is perpendicular to U. And the component of P which is parallel to U is easy to establish simply by the definition of a dot product. So if U is a unit vector, which is how we're setting this up, then the length of the component of P which is parallel to U can be found simply by taking the dot product of U dot P. And the direction of that vector is just U, the unit vector U. And so this simple formula then gives us the component P parallel. P perp is just P minus P parallel. So this is also a simple formula. Insert the definition of P parallel right there. And so we now have expressions for both P parallel and P perp. So now what we're going to do is we're going to define a third vector. So we have our original vector, U. We have, P parallel is in the direction of U. We have P perp, which is the component of P, which is perpendicular to U. And now we're going to get a third direction, W, which is orthogonal to both of those directions, U and P perp. And so we get that by taking the cross product. product. The cross product between U and P perp is going to give us a third direction, which is a 90 degrees clockwise rotation of P perp around that vector U. That's what the cross product gives. And note that, in fact, P parallel is in the direction of U. So we can actually sneak P parallel inside the parentheses here because U cross P parallel is just zero because P parallel is in the direction of U. So the cross product of those two vectors will give us zero. So in fact, U cross P perp is just U cross P parallel plus P perp, and that's just P. So W is just U cross P. So now we have three vectors. We have P parallel, which when we do rotation, nothing's going to happen because that's in the direction about which we're rotating, right? So that's our U is our rotation axis, and so nothing's going to happen in the direction P parallel. That component's going to stay the same. And we have P perp and a 90 degrees clockwise rotation of P perp about U, and that's called W. So now we can put it all together. If we think about a rotation of P about a unit vector U by an angle theta, the component of P in the direction of U will remain unchanged. And so P prime, so after the rotation, is just the component of P that's in the direction of U. P parallel is going to remain unchanged, and so that will just remain there. And P perp will possibly rotate. And so if we're rotating by an angle zero, then cos zero is one and sine zero is zero, and so we'll just have no rotation, and P prime will just be P parallel plus P perp. If theta is equal to pi over two, then this term will be zero, and this term will be 1, and so P prime will just be P parallel plus W, the 90 degree rotation of P perp. And if theta is somewhere between 0 and pi over 2, then we'll have a little bit of component of P perp and a little bit of component of W. And so, so that theta then, and in fact for any value of theta, that theta represents the rotation in the plane spanned by P perp and W of the component that was originally P perp before it was rotated with theta is equal to 0. Okay, so now we've put together P prime in terms of P parallel and P perp and the rotated value of P perp combined with the angle theta with a cosine and a sine. And so now all we have to do is plug in the expressions that we have up here. So P parallel is U dot P times U. P perp, we have an expression for that. We put that in there. And W, we have an expression for that. So we put that there. And so if we compare this expression for P prime to this one, term by term, we have a P cos theta, we have U dot P times U times 1, we have a U dot P times U times minus cos theta, and we have a U cross P times sine theta. So all of those terms are there. So we verified this formula that we set out to show. One final little bit here is that we want to be able to express this relationship between P prime and P via our rotation matrix R. We're trying to gain an understanding of this rotation matrix R here. And so we can pull that out of this formula via this expression. And at least two of these terms are quite simple to do. And so let's look at this form. So we have P prime is P cos theta. So if we write that as P prime is equal to something times P, well, that's just I times cos theta if that something is a matrix. So that's easy to write. Now let's look at the next term here. U dot P, that's just a scalar, right? So we can move that scalar after the U. So we can have, and we can think of this dot product as just U transpose times P. And we'll put that expression after here. So we can write this as U times U transpose times P. So grouping U and U transpose together, that's a matrix. So we have U and U transpose, the scalar 1 minus cos theta will pull out in front. And so we have U times U transpose times P. That's that second term right there. The last term, we have a sine theta times U cross P. So now we have this vector cross product. That's not in a matrix vector form yet. And so what we can do is we can appeal to a convenient little identity here, where if you have a vector cross product, we can write it as a matrix vector product by developing a special skew symmetric matrix from the first vector here. So we can write A cross B as some matrix times the vector B, where that matrix is of this form. And the easiest way to see this is true is just to multiply it out and verify that it's correct. Then you can use it henceforth and forevermore. So go ahead and plug this in there, write out B1, B2, and B3, multiply it together, multiply it out, and see what the first component of the product is, the second component of the product is, and the third component of the product is, and boom, that's exactly what you get by taking A cross B. So this is a valid identity that you can use. And so if we have U cross P, we can express it as this matrix built from now the vector U times P. And so the third component of this expression for the rotation matrix R in this case is given by sine theta times this skew symmetric matrix that we can build from the vector U. So that then is a matrix expression corresponding to Rodriguez's rotation formula, which we established here. So this is a starting point to understand what R is. R is still too complicated to work with conveniently here. And so we're going to have a couple more videos that first discuss how we can embed this formula in a very clever arithmetic, which is formed by a generalization of the complex plane called quaternions. And that's a very elegant framework to consider this. And then we're also going to extend this to consider how R can be related to roll, pitch, and yaw, so Euler rotation sequences and the related Tate-Bryan rotation sequences. And then we'll try to relate all of these expressions for how we can relate R to simpler concepts back together, and so then we can have a good understanding of what a solid body rotation is, and from there we'll be able to move on to the subject of dynamics.